Thank you, Rosemary. And I have a couple of words of thanks. First, to Belinda for organizing this critical conversation here at Rutgers. And second, to the other panelists. You know, we're just two left. And before long, it'll just be one. But nonetheless, I wanted to say this, that, you know, I think that the Black protest movements in Europe last spring have really inspired an outpouring of webinars just like this one. And it tends to be the same folks who keep getting tapped to share their insights and expertise. And I just wanted to recognize their time and energy and commitment to keep participating in these exchanges. I think that unequal burden sharing is increasingly recognized, or to some extent at least, when it comes to academic service. But I think it's much less so with regards to the division of intellectual labor in the academy. So I hope the explosion of interest in Black Europe outlasts our current moment, and that sooner rather than later, many more Europeanists could be called upon to say something meaningful about Black Lives Mattering in Europe. So some of the webinars that I've seen on BLM in Europe this fall have taken the form of a question: do Black Lives Matter in Europe? And in a riff on that formulation, as my point of departure today, I would like to ask, does Europe matter to Black lives in France? I think it does, in important ways that often get overlooked in both historical research and public debates about identity, inequality, and belonging in France today. The national narrative about France's distinctive political culture of Republican universalism and color evasiveness, to use Amelia's term from the morning, is still so robust that transnational perspectives on the African diaspora and those racialized as Black in France that point beyond the bounds of France's former empire or the Francophone Afro-Atlantic world have really made little headway in and out of the academy. So in the first part of my remarks today, I'll consider how the transnational and interdisciplinary field of Black European studies challenges both that French national narrative and French academic norms about what constitutes legitimate forms of knowledge. I'll also point to some of the limits of that challenge and suggest a few ways we might push the needle even further. And I'll conclude with a few very preliminary sketches about the resonance of transnational modes of identification in France and Europe more broadly today. So, you know, maybe at this point in the program today, an overview of Black European studies will seem redundant, but nonetheless, I'll take a minute to just highlight some of the signal contributions of this exciting emergent field. For more than two decades now, a growing body of work on Black Europe has been challenging traditional ways of thinking about European history, the boundaries of Europe, and what it means to be European. This rich literature also unsettles conventional frameworks for studying the global African diaspora and notions of Blackness that have long privileged the historical trajectory of Afro-descendants in the Americas and in the US especially. So put simply, as Kira and Kaneta, who was also supposed to be here, have argued in Black Perspectives in 2016, Black Europe is a useful category of historical analysis. It's also a provocation that demolishes the racist equation of European and white. It makes invisible histories visible, and it opens up new perspectives on Black globality. So Black Europe brings Europe more fully into the Black Atlantic, where of course it has always been envisioned, but somehow as soon as you say Black Atlantic, it sort of cleaves wherever you're talking about out of Europe and pulls it into this Black space, you know, preserving, you know, the whiteness of Europe. So Black Europe brings Europe more fully into the Black Atlantic, but it also really pushes beyond it, inviting other ways of thinking comparatively and transnationally about Black histories and processes of racial formation. So the rise of Black European studies, I would suggest, is an especially welcome and potentially transformative development for French scholars working on the African diaspora, those racialized as Black, and anti-Black racism in France. The intellectual legitimacy of that kind of research is still frequently called into question in French academia, especially when put forth by junior scholars who themselves come from racialized and minoritized groups. a 2019 special issue of the journal Mouvement, titled Intersectionality, offered a grim look at the way such scholars and their work are not only devalued by many of their white colleagues, but also are blamed for everything from the supposed plague of identity politics in French society at large, to everything from the collapse of the workers' movement and the uptick in Islamist terrorism in recent years. So against that inhospitable national backdrop, the increasing salience of Black Europe as a transnational research agenda in Europe, not just or even primarily among American academics, which is really key, so it's not seen as a foreign import by, American scholars who white French academics think are obsessed with race and either misguidingly or maliciously are importing these irrelevant and inappropriate racial paradigms into French studies. You know, this sense that Black European studies, study of Black Europe, is an indigenous European development is really key and potentially a game changer. As Black European studies has come together as a field, it's created new sites of transnational intellectual exchange and sociability, like the biennial Afro-Europeans Conference, which if anybody ever has an opportunity to go to, I strongly suggest you do. It's unlike any other European conference space that you see, where marginalized scholars can find professional recognition, intellectual stimulation and camaraderie, and where delegitimized and undervalued knowledge about Black France can flourish. So institutionally, professionally, and thematically, Black European studies poses a transnational challenge to a good deal of business as usual in the French academe. But the transnational interpretive possibilities of Black Europe as an analytical framework and its ramifications for how we think about Black histories and racial formation in France or in any other national context in Europe for that matter, I think have yet to be fully fleshed out. Kira won't be here for the Q&A, but I would have posed this as a question to all of the other panelists working in different national contexts, but maybe the rest of the audience can take this up in discussion. The very corpus that historicizes Black Europe, studies of Afro-Germans, Black British, Black France, Black Italy, and so on, certainly encourages comparison, but it's not always clear if Black European history amounts to something more than the sum of its parts. Transnational Black politics, intellectual exchange, activism, and sociability are perhaps easiest to see in the Europe of the present, but this too, of course, has a history. Though Europe has often been the level at which racial formation and racist exclusion takes place, and indeed, as Amelia reminded us earlier, where white supremacy was born, a countervailing tradition of Francophone thought has imagined transnational Europe rather differently as a space of potentially greater inclusion, empowerment, and belonging than the nation state could ever offer. For some African politicians and activists in France after World War II, the incorporation of French Africa in the transnational Europe that was then only just starting to take shape presented an attractive alternative to either remaining under the exclusive orbit of the French Republic or acceding to national independence. The most prominent champion of this view, as many people might know, was famed Negritude poet and first president of independent Senegal, Léopold Sédar Senghor. In the late 1940s and 1950s, Senghor served as a deputy in the French National Assembly for some 15 years, and perhaps less well known, also served as one of the French delegates to the European Parliamentary Assembly in Strasbourg. He was an ardent European federalist, but of a particular kind. Senghor believed that by bringing the rest of Europe into the France-Africa relationship, by creating Eurafrica, Africans would be more free in their home countries, in France, and elsewhere in Europe. He also believed that a Eurafrican federation would provide a viable framework for greater African unity on the continent, solidarity with the diaspora, and more symmetrical relations between Europe and Africa overall. Senghor's vision of Eurafrica was definitely idiosyncratic. For most of his contemporaries, Eurafrica was motivated by a colonialist ethos of exploiting Africa's immense natural wealth and human resources for European gain. As a result, the term itself is super toxic in contemporary French discourse, as former French President Nicolas Sarkozy belatedly learned after invoking it in a spectacularly out of touch and much maligned speech at the University of Dakar in 2007 while he was president. It's important to know. But nevertheless, the core of Senghor's Euro-African vision has retained a hold on the Francophone imagination. In her latest book, Cameroon-born writer Leonora Miano conjures up Afropeia, which she calls a, quote, post-Western and post-racist utopia. So not a post-racial, but a post-racist utopia. Miano has been a key popularizer of the term Afropean in French literature for the past decade. And in a recent interview, she characterized Afropeans as a potentially transformative, regenerative force for European societies that could help Europeans finally overcome their colonial impulses, much as Senghor had figured an egalitarian Euro-Africa as a form of decolonization for both Europe and Africa some 70 years earlier. Miano likewise suggests that Afropeans' attachment to Africa could neutralize Europe's rapacious and extractive designs on the continent and recalibrate Europe-Africa relations in the interest of both parties. And yet, in another echo of Senghor, she calls on Afropeans to organize themselves in a Europe-wide federation to create identifiable Afropean institutions and establish permanent liaisons and contacts with Euro deputies. She forcefully extols what she calls Afropean lobbying at the European level to advance Afropean claims in different European national contexts. So Miano's Afropean conceptual repertoire seems to resonate with young people in France. Just how much is at this point hard to say, but to take a very small and super unscientific sample, we can look to Amandine Gay's very powerful 2017 documentary, Ouvrir la Voix, or Speak Up, which is constructive out of extensive on-camera interviews with dozens of Black women in continental France. And just for those who teach Black Europe or about Black Germany, you know, the film would pair extremely well with the Showing Our Colors anthology, amplifying the voices of, Afropean women across the continent, or at least in a comparative transnational perspective. So in a segment in Amandine Gay's film, in which the women are asked how they self-identify, two of the seven who respond on screen say they prefer Afropean. The first says that she first encountered the term in Miano's work and that it spoke to her instantly. And you can really see this intense emotion. Like, she is so moved by the term and, you know, how deeply and profoundly it resonated and provided, you know, sort of this very unexpected alternative that she had never thought of and, you know, is herself sort of surprised by its resonance. And the second woman, who identifies with this term, says that Afropean, likewise, incredibly in this moving register, is the only term that she feels allows her to express what she says is her, is that she is France-born, Afro-descendant, and noir in a way that she says isn't torn, but rather peaceful and healthy. She adds, and I quote, "The word Afropean allows me to reconcile all that in a way that's more calm. Finally, there is a word that links my French culture with my Afro-Caribbean culture." So the appeal of Afropean as an identity for this woman is clearly deeply imprinted with her place, her location in France, and her connection to French and Afro-French culture. But when we look at formulations of Afropean in other national contexts, we encounter some very similar logics and rationales. Sheffield-born Johnny Pitts, in his 2019 travelogue, Afropean, Tales from Black Europe, says the term Afropean, and I quote, "encouraged me to think of myself as whole and unhyphenated. Here was a space where Blackness was taking part in shaping European identity at large. It suggested the possibility of living in and with more than one idea, Africa and Europe, without being mixed this, half that, or Black other." So to be sure, as even the super small sampling in Gay's film makes clear, there's no one monolithic way that Black women in France today see themselves. Two of Gay's interlocutors actually unreservedly self-identify as French. A third identifies as Afro-descendant, and another simply as une Afro, an Afro. And incidentally, Gay herself has said in public appearances elsewhere that she also prefers that term Afro, precisely because it links her to, you know, particular histories and cultures in Africa and the Antilles, which of course we've seen was also the logic for Afropean, and which probably is also the logic for Afro descendants. So, you know, it's a real effective register and question that we're dealing with here. But regardless of whether they identify with terms, you know, with any of these women identify with terms like Afropean that have explicitly European overtones, it is super clear that the women in Gay's film are wrestling with questions of identity, belonging, and racialization that are widely shared across the African diaspora in contemporary Europe. So, you know, and this is my concluding thought, I've been very quick, a nation-based approach that rehearses the ritualistic return to French universalism and colorblindness endowed with seemingly endless explanatory power clearly won't do full justice to their histories, lived experience, or diasporic horizons. The transnational potential of a Black European framework may fare much better. And that's it.
Thank you so much, Emily, for that. That was absolutely wonderful. And I have a question for you. I work specifically in the Black German context, and there are tensions in that field between American scholars and the actual community of Black Germans in Germany. And I'm wondering if such tensions exist in Black French studies.
Yeah, I think it's complicated. A lot of, you know, France-born scholars that work on Black France are trained in the US because there is so few, there's just like no opportunity and institutional support for doing that in France. So a lot of the work that these scholars put out, you know, I mean, it's coming from members of that community, right? Even if they're trained here and abroad. So it's a slightly different situation. Although I would say that, you know, I mentioned that there's a lot of frustration with, certainly on the part of, you know, the white French public and white academics that, you know, so many Americans keep coming to France to study race in France. You know, this is when I signed, you know, first got my library card at the French National Library and I told the librarian what I was working on. It was just like, oh, another one. It's all you care about, you know, the Algerian War and Vichy and race. Like, what is wrong with you Americans? So I think that, because, you know, the Black French community feels so excluded from French academia, there's less hostility toward, you know, as they would say, like Anglo-Saxon, so both like British and American research, you know, that is opening up these fields more in France.
Thank you for that. Are there other questions? Linda?
I feel like I'm asking too many questions. anyway, I'll just throw one in. This was just, again, another such a wonderful talk. And I guess I'm thinking about how, what sense there is of ways to be able to manage the plurality of identities and ways in which you think it would be appropriate in any kind of policy level, following policy, or I mean, is it, how does it go beyond individual choice in terms of self-identification? How should it, what are any kinds of legal, cultural, other sorts of ramifications that might come from these these different kind of, you know, self-characterizations, and are there tensions among them? Are there tensions among them? I'll leave it at that.
Well, that's a really great question. I mean, I think, you know, so in France, there is a real taboo about talking about race at all. And there's a taboo about using racial language. You know, we associate that with like a longstanding color evasive tradition. But in fact, you know, in the immediate post-war period, which is the period that I work on, you know, the Constitution of the Fourth Republic, and then again of the Fifth Republic, stated very explicitly that French Republican values are against discrimination on the basis of race. And as, you know, communities of color, not just Black French, but other activists in Europe, in France right now, have been increasingly sort of energized and making, you know, sort of broader claims and recriminations on the basis of this idea of state racism, racisme d'état, the response of the parliament was actually to remove the word race from the constitution, precisely in that clause saying that the constitution is against racial discrimination. So the maneuver there was to say that, like, oh, well, if you're accusing us of the state of racism, you know, we'll prove to you that we're not racist by getting rid of race, which was a protection from the constitution. And that happened just 2 years ago. So, you know, I think that for, you know, the women, for instance, in Amandine Gay's film, you know, all of those primary identifications, none of them used the word, you know, a racial descriptor. And yet in a separate segment where they were asked about the increasing use of the word black in French, which has been imported and is increasingly used in TV, in, you know, printed material, in everyday conversation, you know, they are super pissed about that, right? Like, this is a way of preserving the French language from saying noir, of externalizing, you know, the question of race, and, you know, that French people feel so comfortable saying, oh, les blacks, les blacks, les blacks, but they would never feel comfortable saying noir to any of, you know, these women, right? And even in, you know, the dubbing of English language TV programs, where every other word is translated, where they say, where the English word is black, they use black instead of noir. And so I think that even as you see this proliferation of identities, because of the taboo against talking openly about race and confronting these legacies of, you know, all the legacies of enslavement and colonialism and, you know, post-colonial amnesia, you know, they're, these communities wouldn't want to see that further erasure of race as a category, a meaningful category of analysis, and also, you know, push their, you know, white co-citizens to, you know, speak the word noir, right? As opposed to, you know, these sort of impressive, evasive maneuvers.
Carolyn Laurent makes a comment in the chat. I think it is more a question of representation, speaking for oneself in France. Scholars in France that work on such questions and that are visible are white, so self-representation is also important.
Yeah, I think that, you know, the special issue of this journal that I mentioned, you know, these were all sort of, you know, coming up through the ranks scholars, and that like a couple of very prominent faces that do work on this, whose legitimacy isn't questioned, are white. But there are also Black scholars like Papandai and Achille Mbembe, and, you know, there are Black faces that are also like the talking heads in other documentaries when they're like called on to talk about racism in France, right? But yeah, no, I think that the question of representation is important.
Are there other questions? comments?
I kept my remarks short so that we could all discuss all the other panelists, since I suspected I would just be on the hot seat by myself. So, you know, we can also just talk and I don't have to be the target of any reflections.
I'll leave the floor open then. Are there any issues from any of the that you'd like to speak about, or any other questions or comments you'd like to make?
May I? No. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Just a question linked to this notion of Afropean, and I was interested in how you describe in the movie Ouvrir la Voix, that two women felt very strongly that this would define them. But I'm also wondering, in the case of France, isn't it, because it's Afropean, it's not linking to France, it's almost erasing this need to speak of race in France. And you know, I really like this idea of Afropean, but how those people are happy to use it if it's not, you know, diverting to the need to talk about race in France.
Is yeah. Clear? Yeah, no, absolutely. You know, I think, again, you know, to put, so the organization of the film is that there is a question that all of her, you know, 60 or so respondents, they all are asked exactly the same questions. They basically have been given a survey. And then, you know, there is, you know, she constructs the segments out of whoever she wants to feature, right? And so one of those women who chooses to identify with Afropean is also in that other segment where, you know, the respondents, her interlocutors are being asked this question about, il s'agit d'une black, right? And noir, because they're in France, is so important. Like, it's so important to acknowledge noir as a French category in reality, that I think while on the one hand it diverts that, you know, that's not the only, that's not actually the only way that, you know, these women really see themselves, right? But I don't know. I'm it's an effective question. I normally don't work on this kind of, you know, very personal register. So this is my first foray into thinking about it. But it's a great question. I'll think about it. Okay, so Jeremy Popkin has a question about the relationship of Black or Afropean identity and Muslim communities, especially in France. Yeah, that's also a very good question. I think that, you know, there's great work out there on, you know, Tricca Keaton, who was also at one point supposed to be here today, who I would have loved to hear her thoughts on a number of questions that came up. You know, she works very much in the vein of Black Europe, but she also, her earlier work is on France and Black Muslim girlhood in France. And, you know, I think that for a lot of these communities, you know, that is part of the way that others feel is Muslimness is racialized, is just sort of attached to Blackness as opposed to North Africanness, right? So we see that sort of racial and religious twinning of registers of exclusion. So I don't think that's necessarily all that different, even if we tend to think about Islam primarily with other communities. Mm-hmm. But I don't know about Afropean. I'll have to dig more into how people who identify that way, you know, if, you know, how they relate to Islam, if they come from a Muslim background.
Yeah. If yeah. I can
throw
in an additional comment, I was thinking of a news story I read a couple of years ago about how the French Catholic Church is recruiting increasing numbers of priests from Black sub-Saharan countries because of the lack mm-hmm. of new ordinations in France. So you have a Black French Christian community, mm-hmm. And you have a North African community that is mostly Muslim. It's all very complicated.
Yeah, I mean, so, you know, I guess I don't know exactly how to answer the question with regard to the Afropean, sort of this new Afropean conceptual repertoire, but, you know, in my own work, which looks at, you know, sub-Saharan African youth in France in the 1940s and 50s, I mean, religion is very important, you know, part of, you know, for African Catholics, part of their sense of exclusion is compounded by the fact that they're not finding as welcome a home in, you know, metropolitan French Catholic communities, where, you know, those might have been sort of, you know, a bastion of respite in the more, you know, segregationist regimes on the ground in French Africa at the time. And, you know, for sub-Saharan African Muslims, I mean, they're really, they're feeling the persecution of both the laïcité and the preference for Catholicism. So for them, you know, that's a it's a double assault on, you know, the supposed politics of pluralism and like turning the tables on colonialism with the French Union, and they feel, you know, sort of triply excluded in that sense.
Yeah. Thank you.
We have a question that was a little bit overlooked from Hillary Silver. She asks if we can address the June Black Lives Matter demonstrations themselves and police racism beyond subjective identity.
Yeah, sure. So, you know, the outpouring of Black activists into the street in Paris in June, you know, that coincided, you know, of course you had the reaction to the murder of George Floyd here, but it was also a couple days, just a couple days after there was a verdict to not, that there was no, there was no criminal liability in another case in France, you know, the 21-year-old Black French man, Adama Traoré, who was in a very similar situation, pinned to the ground and asphyxiated by the police in a, you know, sort of dubious attempt, a dubious arrest on dubious grounds, you know, just before the, you know, what became, or what was read as a Black Lives Matter protest, you know, in response to George Floyd, there was this ruling in that case, which is, you know, several years old now, and they keep trying to get, have a different outcome. So this other movement, Justice for Adama, was really the focal point of the demonstrations, and it had this you know, dual, or it converged with what was happening globally around George Floyd. You know, there were signs, you know, that had both Adama and George Floyd's name saying "I can't breathe," you know, as they both you know, perished in that same way. So, you know, the sense that, you know, this was primarily a response to what happened in the United States, I think is misleading. And that, you know, these uprisings and protest movements in France over police brutality to communities of color, not just Black French, but French from a variety of immigrant backgrounds in the banlieue. I mean, this goes back to the 1980s and 90s, you know, the 2005 insurrections or riots, depending how you want to call them, was a response to the death of two teens, you know, who were being chased by the police. So there's a long indigenous history of French, you know, non-white French communities, you know, protesting and rising up against police brutality. I don't know if I agree with the comment earlier that, you know, it was only getting attention now because of, you know, the BLM protests here, but maybe it has greater resonance, you know, in some quarters, I'm not sure. But I think that it's been front and center in France for some time.
Yes, and certainly in Germany as well. We mm-hmm. have two follow-up comments here, one from Jason Groves, who states that he's not a scholar of French, but he found Jean Beeman's Citizen Outsider, Children of North African Immigrants in France, illuminating, and Carolyn Laurent's comments. Abd al-Malik is a Black Muslim man converted as a young man, and he has also addressed such questions quite a lot in his writings and music. If you'd like to comment on those.
I mean, I guess I'll just say that there is a lot of literature out there about, you know, Black identities and Muslim identities. In my hesitancy, I was trying to really not overstate anything with regard to that very specific Afropean concept, which I just don't know. But there is really rich literature and, you know, Black African Muslim writers are, you know, very prominent in Francophone literature, and they reflect on precisely these issues. I mean, going back to Sheikh Amadou Khan's Ambiguous Adventure. So there's like a long corpus of work that reflects on these identities, these questions.
You mentioned in the context of Amandine Gay's film, in the German context, showing our colors and sort of compared the two. I'm wondering if there is a comparative movement. In other words, we talk about the Black Lives Matter, not the Black Lives Matter, but the Black German movement in Germany. Has there been, or is there, a Black French movement?
Certainly not at the time when, you know, that Afro-German movement starts to form and gain steam. You know, I think that it's really in the 2000s that you get Black activism in France that identifies primarily as Black. And there are a couple different reasons for that. There's a longer history of coalitional activism of racialized populations that aren't exclusively Black. And that is one piece. I think the sort of tensions between Antillean activists and African activists who at least for a long time didn't necessarily see their interests as the same and didn't relate to their French identity in the same way. You know, people in the French Caribbean have been French citizens for, you know, what year is this? Close to 200 years, depending on who they were and where they were. You know, for people issued from immigration, that relationship to Frenchness is more complicated. And, you know, among Black French, or, you know, the African diaspora in France, those racialized as Black in France, you know, there wasn't necessarily a unifying identity under the category noir. And you start having organizations founded in like the mid 2000s that are identifying precisely in that way, that are creating a sort of apparatus for activism and mobilization that is precisely Black. But even still today, you know, there's been a lot of activism in the academy, but also outside the academy, that has, you know, really been coalitional, that is thinking about anyone who's a victim of, you know, what activists and scholars call racisme d'état, state racism. So anyone who is racisé, you know, in these different spaces of actual non-mixed or non-mixité. So what's the translation for that? So like not open to white people, right? That there is this, you know, growing world of activism that is happening that excludes white people, but that includes everybody else. And so you have sort of these very complex, different layers of activism and mobilization that I wouldn't say is necessarily comparable to the Afro-German movement.
Yeah, I'm also thinking that perhaps it has something to do with the isolation of Black Germans prior to the 80s.
Yeah.
That was not quite the same in France, and perhaps the migrant communities or the post-colonial communities held on to their identities differently than the Black Germans who were actually indigenous to Germany and didn't sort of come from someplace else. I'm wondering if that had something also to do with the lack of a necessity of a unified voice stating we are Black and French. I don't know, I'm just suggesting that maybe a little. Yeah.
I think that the power, I mean, the taboo on talking about race is really powerful in France. And for folks that wanted to, you know, be included and be recognized as French, you know, that identifying precisely in that way creates, would create a wedge there, right? So, so I do, I think it took a lot of academic activism to, you know, get, you know, race as a category recognized and talked about a lot more, that started, and, you know, the way that, you know, people were being educated in universities to like have a more emboldened stance.
Mm-hmm. And Belinda asked you, do these kinds of splits also figure among those of Northern and sub-Saharan African descent?
Yeah, it's a good question. I mean, again, I think that there's been certainly recently a lot of coalitional activism, you know, that definitely bridges that divide. But a lot, I mean, the big protest movement in the 1980s in France was a North African movement that, you know, was not in any particular way explicit about being coalitional or inclusive of sub-Saharan Africans or, you know, other folks racialized as Black in France. So, so it's a different history.
Belinda, would you like to have something to say before we close?
Really, I want those who are left, if you will, unmute your mics and we can, for Emily and also in the immediate memory of the entire event, we can clap also for our wonderful moderator, Rosemary Peña. So thank you so much. And yeah, I think this ends the formal event. I'm so sorry it wound up being, not integrated as originally intended because of different timing needs. But the talks were all so wonderful. So thanks to everyone for participating, and obviously especially to our panelists and the moderators. So we can say goodbye now.
Thank you, everyone. That was really fun. And I really appreciate all the great questions. Thanks.
Are there any further comments before we close? Should we just close then? Thanks everyone for coming, and have a wonderful rest of your afternoon. And I hope to see many of you again.
Thank you so much.
Belinda, did you have something to say?
Yeah, I was just individually removing those who were left. I think they were, I think they may have been people who were away from their computer for a second or whatever, but I was just like, I thought, I wound up doing this when we've had these kind of little post-event receptions. Like, I think people just, you know, they're not paying attention, or they walked away for a minute. And I think if we're gonna start talking among ourselves, you know, I mean, it's fine for there to be other random people, but like, two of my undergraduates were there. I didn't know the, you know. So thank you both so much. I'm so sorry that we didn't, if we'd started it earlier, it would have worked so much better. And the thing that really just, you know, the kicker is that two of my colleagues said they were coming with their graduate classes, which is why we made it when we did.
Oh.
And then they never even showed up.
Oh, boo.
So that's, you know, that's what happened. But also, if I had, you know, put together what people had told me earlier, which is, you know, I mean, I'm usually much better at keeping track of people's timing needs. I would have, in fact, just made it earlier anyway, notwithstanding. Anyway, blah, 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 as the Germans say, blah, blah, blah.
All the talks were really great.
Talks were great. And I just really wished it had been a more integrated discussion, because the ways that they fit together also were so holistically wonderful. I couldn't have been more excited about the presentations. Emily, thanks for your great presentation, and also for your suggestions of people. Sadia, I wound up having to go teach. I thought she was going to be able to stay with us afterward too. But you know, that would be great if, as Sadia was saying before, if we could, you know, go ahead and do, you know, more things next semester. I myself will be on leave next year, although I may then come back as to finish up a second term as you know, with European studies. But in any case, you know, there are different venues and forums in which we can have these kinds of discussions. And this was just like, I just found it so fabulous and so energizing. So I'm hoping
that's great.
And my organization, the Black German Heritage and Research Association, is anchoring itself at Rutgers Camden with Keith Green in Africana Studies.
That is fabulous.
We had to postpone our conference, but I'm sure there will be other events.
And you're going to wait until it can happen in person, right? Rather
than that particular conference, yes, but we may have other kinds of events in the meanwhile. But for us, it's really important for us to all come together.
Yeah. Oh, well, can you please keep me in the loop on that?
Absolutely.
Rosemary, that's great.
And me too. And insofar as whether I'm directly direct or not, I feel like I can make a commitment on behalf of the center, you know, to help support, you know, at least in some form, help support that conference when it happens. So, you know, if you would like that.
And one of the things that we are thinking about is expanding beyond Black Germanists now that everybody's gone, let me tell you why I'm interested in expanding a little bit further. I hinted a little bit at Emily, because right now I'm an adoptee, right, from Germany. Leopold Sedersinger is my uncle. And I just reunited with my paternal family My father was a diplomat from Senegal to Germany at the time. This is my ancestral home in Germany, in Schleswig-Holstein. My mother was German and my father was Jean-Pierre Fay, the diplomat. So obviously I'm swallowing everything I can now about France, Senegal, and that history. So when you said Leopold Sedar Senghor, Keith and I were texting each other.
Well, that's amazing. Wow.
Yeah. So hopefully we will expand our reach to Afro-Europeanness as opposed to only Black German in the future, and we'll have to talk.
Yeah, that's great. So, I mean, is this like specifically regional, or is it people come from all over, or is there
Well, because of the relationship and the ideology of the conference, obviously I'm the founder, I created the conference. And the intention originally was because I, as an academic, had the privilege of traveling to Germany, meeting all of the academics, but my adoptee cohort did not. Nor did the Black Germans in America who were non-adopted. So what I do in my conference is I invite the Black Germans to keynote, to speak to us, sort of strengthening our transnational, transatlantic connection was the first event. And they're all taped and they're all videoed and they're all online on our website. But we, the question that I asked you about the tensions, because it's a big issue for us here. And so our answer, because of course that's a problem for us, right? Because we want that history and we have been erased from that history. So, but what we thought was sort of a way to do that with respect to our community is to invite community members to be keynotes and then others who happen to be studying us to present in front of us, so that we can respond directly to these presentations. And it's really worked out well. And then, because of also, like you said, the exclusion in the universities there, and obviously the same in France, we invite activists, cultural artists, and performers as well. And then we have experiential panels, so that actual Black Germans who may not be academics from Germany or living here in the States can also speak. And you'd be surprised at how many Black Germans there are here in the US. And also when we did our conference in Toronto, there were Black Germans in Toronto. So that's why we have our conference the way we do, because we're a little bit selfish. We want there to be a Black German studies, but we also respect the tensions that are being felt in Germany about recolonizing our history.
Fascinating.
So, yeah.
Yeah.
And I know Amandine too, because she's an adoptee and my work is on adoption. So we do adoption conferences together. So it's really a small world.
And there's I didn't know that. That's amazing. That's amazing.
And there's so much, I'm excited. I mean, there's so much we can talk about, even the films, Girls or even Mignonette, because I watched that with my sister who lives in Berlin, who obviously is Senegalese and who spent quite a bit of her lifetime in Paris. So I have sisters in Paris, Berlin, and brothers in Senegal now. So it's all coming together for me.
Wow. So there's on Canopy that we have through Rutgers is another great short film called Too Black to Be French. And it's one woman documentarian sort of going through her family tree and her grandfather was an African diplomat. And so, yeah, I think you'd really enjoy it. It's very short too. It's like 50 minutes. And yeah, you know, so my closest collaborator and really good friend, Christy Pekikaro, who I have co-edited several special issues with, and I have organized countless events with, I had no idea that she, that her mother was Afro-German.
Oh, wow.
I had no idea. I just thought that, you know, she had an African-American background. I didn't know. I was shocked. I found out maybe 2 years into our friendship. I was just like.
One thing I did not say in the chat, someone brought in when we were talking about the German portion with Kira, and they brought up the documentaries. Oh, no, this was earlier, about Black German adoption. And the reason, just so you know, that I did not comment on them is because my dissertation critiques them terribly. They are horrible. And they are not representative. Of Black German adoption. So I'm not advertising them, but because obviously I know the people, I'm also not going to publish my dissertation because it's kind of like, I don't want to hurt the people who told their stories, but I feel like the people who told their stories were being exploited by the people who discovered them, and adoptees are vulnerable, and it's kind of cathartic. But then what they do is they generalize, and this becomes the Black German adoptee experience, and no one has any background in adoption. So, I mean, sometimes these books, films, or whatever, I just spoke in England, and I say they really do more harm than good.